Glad to be back.
You. We are back here again with another question for you.
Okay, I'm ready.
Last time we were talking about art and whatnot, but we decided that we were going to ask you what isn't art, because that's kind of important, because a lot of things that are called art are foisted upon us every day, and you seem to have an insight that many should hear.
Now, I have to realize that all my insights are not coming from the known world per se. As a shaman, the Tolteca lineage is responsible for making art of the unknown. And artists today can make art of the known, which would be portraits, landscapes, or even graffiti letters, but and more artists even of the unknown to some degree, where you question the abstract painting. But the intention in that case might just be colors, composition, nice arrangement of things, still coming from a known perspective. As a sorcerer, all the arts that a sorcerer produces are to move the assemblage point of the viewer or the listener out of any connection to the known. It's to make them question things. But I can give you examples of artists whose attempt to do that in the past is still working today in the contemporary world. Van Gogh, for example, still brings in large groups of people. They want to experience a spiritual impact of paintings that are of landscape or portraiture, because there's something energetically in his work that bridges into what I'm talking about, the unknown and the intention that a sorcerer would have. Was someone like Van Gogh a sorcerer? No. He wanted to become a priest in his past, so he was searching for a mystical spiritual experience in his life through his art. But I think that for most of his life, he was trapped in the idea that I have to depict something that is recognizable. At the end of his career, at his very last painting, which I was very fortunate to see just recently at the Van Gogh Museum in Amsterdam, he actually made it. It's not the wheat field with the flying ravens that most people think is his last work. What it is a small painting, and I believe his inspiration, I believe, were dried tree branches. But what it looks like is an abstract configuration with a bridge to the known, and that you think maybe they're tree branches, to the unknown, because they look like abstract shapes. And then, with combining the known and the unknown, the viewer is moved to the unknowable. And I think that's what happened to Van Gogh. He himself committed suicide because he had reached that threshold which not even he could comprehend. It wasn't about energetic strokes. It wasn't about painting something that was in the known. It was some territory that stretched out way beyond his experience and was a place that he could only interpret as insanity. Now, for a sorcerer, they have a map, which always gives them relief from thinking that they're insane. One of the things an artist in the Toltecan tradition always has is the fact that they have a lineage behind them that have been exploring this for thousands of years. Those people are not insane. Those people have left the greatest gifts, like the pyramids, that were ever made by artists. So we can look back and say, as our intention is to move like they did the viewer, we are not going insane. We may look to the outside world as insane. That's part of the map. We are supposed to also look like the unknown.
So, if it looks like the known, we're still, what isn't
art? Art is in three categories: the known, portraiture and landscape painting.
Also, that you can call it art, but it has no mystic significance.
Exactly.
And therefore,
yes,
has less value as universally experienceable art.
I think we can use examples. Let's say you go to a temple in India where the artists were asked by the priest to create something that represented their vision of God. Of course, this happens in all religions. The priests are going and saying, how can we build a cathedral that will inspire the known lives of all the people who come to our temple? So you have places in India where the icons and all of the decoration, you have places throughout Europe in temples where all of the artist's products were assembled in order to make a transcendent experience. So they may be known images of a Buddha, they may be known images of a Hindu god, they may be a known image of Jesus on the cross, but that is not the end of the work. The behind-the-scenes purpose of it is to go into the mystic. If the artists have been successful in assembling all this art with that intention over the years, then in many cases the religion still exists, because it is still an inspiring thing for people to see Buddha in a meditative pose. But again, you are paying homage to the mystic artists who worked steadfastly to make these icons. And initially, those were gathered from the unknown, because the priests and the rabbis said, we don't have a menorah. And the artist goes, we will use our skill in aesthetics and balance to create the menorah, which will then represent the oils found in the temple. And you will have that mystic story connected to it. But this sculpture is the thing now that people see. It moves their assemblage point, and they move towards the mystic, as they light the flames. Think of how mystic fire has been used by the artists in all religions to create a mystic feeling. And that's the art that the Toltecs are interested in. That's the art that I produce.
And that isn't art. The next time, we may answer one of your questions right down there where that comment says comments. Ask something.
Ask something of the Nawal. He is here now for a brief time for you.
A limited time only.